Hey, everybody. Nick, you are here to bring you the Sports Roundtable. I'm joined by producer over there, Andrew Walker, pushing the buttons. We're going to get some input from him, as well as him controlling all the controls, making us look very good. We're going to get right into it, starting with the NBA. And it was a very interesting time in the NBA. It's certainly become a yearly league. I mean, it never leads the headlines, and we're pretty much always talking about it. I think we wish to start with all these new teams assembled, a lot of much more balance in the NBA. Everyone's really excited. We were talking about earlier, it's probably the most exciting NBA season people have been looking forward to in a while. And just the parity's now gone. It's a lot more duos as opposed to super teams. And we owe a lot of that to Kawhi Leonard not joining the Lakers, joining the Clippers. And there's a lot of stuff going around. The Lakers are salty about that. But, I mean, it's when you're dealing with Kawhi Leonard, you know who you're dealing with. He could wake up one day thinking something and then go to bed the next doing the entire something else. So I'd like to start with what we think are the favorites in the NBA. And right now, I still think it's the Clippers and the Lakers in the West. Definitely the L.A. teams are leading the way. I think a sleeper in the West would definitely be the Denver Nuggets, just because a lot of these teams have to really work on chemistry, build that continuity. And it's going to take some time, especially in the regular season. They're going to be experimenting a lot, playing with a lot of different lineups, seeing what works, what doesn't. And you know, with the Lakers, there's going to be some drama. Who knows? There could be a coaching change early on where they come out and they really struggle. So I think Denver Nuggets could sneakily have one of the best records in the regular season, along with the Portland Trailblazers, just because they have that continuity. The Golden State Warriors are obviously going to be hurting in that first half of the season without Klay Thompson. So I think those four really need to keep an eye on. But when it comes playoff time, I really think it will be the L.A. teams battling to come out of the West, with the Nuggets and Blazers being more regular season teams racking up those wins. And then in the East, I really think it's all Milwaukee when you look at it now. This year with KD sidelined, Brooklyn's really going to have to just punt on this year and really just try to make it through non-injury-wise, just make it look like it. They're ready, a championship team ready to go when KD returns, get all the requisite parts this year. I really just think it's Milwaukee. They signed Chris Middleton. They got obviously have the best player in the league, Giannis Antetokounmpo. He's going to be taking hopefully another step this year. It's amazing that he could still be improving. They re-signed Brook Lopez, who is very, very good for them, very good in that position, being able to hit that trail three, really space the floor for Giannis, who he can play that small ball five or that small ball four with Brook Lopez. And then they re-signed George Hill. I know they lost Malcolm Brogdon, but they now have George Hill and Eric Bledsoe to run that point guard spot. Should be sustainable there. And I really just think a lot of other teams in the East got worse. Philadelphia obviously got really well, really good defensively by adding Josh Richardson and Al Horford. I just think in the fourth quarter, they're going to be missing Jimmy Butler a lot. Who are you going to go to in the fourth quarter? They're going to be able to double Embiid in the post very easily. And then you have Tyus Harris or Ben Simmons, or Josh Richardson, who you're really hoping to make shots for you in the fourth quarter. I think they'll be a great defensive team, good in the regular season, but I really will think they will struggle until Ben Simmons really develops really a perimeter game. We saw clips of it in social media this week. Obviously, that wasn't against the best competition. Didn't look like they were allowed to get within 5 feet of him, but just seeing him be able to rise up in transition off the dribble and hit a couple threes is a very good sign for Sixers fans. And then other teams in the East, I think Boston got a little bit worse, obviously, by losing Al Horford and the Kyrie Irving. I like the Kemba replacement. I think he could be a little bit better in that Brad Stevens system than Kyrie Irving was. Hopefully that allows Gordon Hayward, Jason Tatum, and Brown to take an even bigger step. Jaylen Brown, and they become those all-stars that Boston really wants them to be, and that's why they didn't pull a trigger on an Anthony Davis or another one of those big trades, because they didn't want to give up Jaylen Brown, Jason Tatum, those two young assets they think will become all-stars. So I really think it's Milwaukee, Philly, and Boston shortly closing behind, but they got worse, I believe, whereas Milwaukee stayed the same, maybe got a little bit better. And then Toronto obviously got a lot worse as well. Andrew, I'd like to get your thoughts on what you think, just kind of how everything's kind of settled now in the NBA and where you think the dominoes align. Who are the favorites? Who do you think are going to be the top challengers come playoff and season time?
I mean, I think we'll just start off with, I absolutely agree, this is going to be probably the most interesting NBA season as a whole in a long time. There is, like you mentioned, there's no super teams. There's no one that's just, you look at and think, oh man, if this team doesn't win, there's no Golden State this year. It's a lot more wide open. I mean, I think in the East, it's really the Sixers and the Bucks. I think they are on paper a tier above the rest of the East. It's just, I mean, you mentioned Boston right there, but I just, you know, with Giannis and Milwaukee and the Sixers, they've just had a solid team for the past couple years. I just don't see anyone competing with those two for the top spot in the East. I think out West, it's a lot more interesting. I think the LA teams are going to be tough to beat. The Lakers, I mean, just LeBron's first year, it seemed like every time they had a little bit of momentum, something happened to kind of derail them. I mean, I know they weren't supposed to do much last year. You know, that wasn't supposed to be the year. It was all building to this year. But still, I think the Lakers, they're going to have a lot going on there, maybe not in a positive way. I just think there's a lot of distractions with being the Lakers that maybe the Clippers won't have. And you got LeBron in LA. It's going to be, there's lots of media. When there's lots of media, there tends to be lots of problems. I was looking at the 538 rankings right here, whatever their simulation came up with. It has the Rockets is actually the number one predicted team.
Yep. Forgot about
them.
It's a good point by 538. Forgot about the Rockets. I definitely think they will be up there as well. We'll take a little bit more time to gel, obviously, with the Russell Westbrook addition, taking Chris Paul out, but theoretically that should be an upgrade. Russell Westbrook is a better player than Chris Paul right now in their stages of their career, so you certainly think the Rockets will be up there as well. Another thing I wanted to talk on with the NBA, and it's Team USA in this World Cup of basketball that they're trying to get going, get off the ground. It's called the World Cup. It's in China coming up this September. And Team USA is losing a lot of players. A lot of key players are not playing. And Kevin Love just announced today that he will not be playing either, becoming the ninth player withdrawing from the team, joining Anthony Davis, James Harden, Damian Lillard, DeMar DeRozan, Bradley Beal, Eric Gordon, Tobias Harris, and CJ McCollum, of players who will not play in the upcoming World Cup of basketball for Coach Popovich and Team USA. They're really trying to get this off the ground with FIBA, have another tournament other than the Olympics, which are in another 2 years in Tokyo, which is obviously where a lot of these guys' goal is. They want to play in that tournament, just not necessarily this one. This leads us with players on Team USA like Kemba Walker, Donovan Mitchell, big guys including Brook Lopez, forwards PJ Tucker. It's a different Team USA team than we've seen. It will not be as deep or as talented, but that doesn't mean it can't succeed. Do you think any reason to worry that the USA won't get gold in an upcoming basketball event, even with so many players pulling out?
I mean, I don't know about worry, but it does open up the tournament a little bit interesting. And if you want the tournament to be more even, it's a good thing for the tournament. I mean, I think without the big names there, you're going to lose a lot of viewership. But I mean, USA in basketball, it's not, they're not quite as dominant as they used to be, but they're still far and away the favorites for gold. And I think even with nine guys sitting out, it's going to be tough for someone else to take gold from them. I think you could see them struggle in a couple games, maybe drop one game early, but when you start putting the medal on the line, start getting to the elimination games, I have a hard time seeing, even with taking out the top nine guys, anyone beating the U.S. I just, you know, other teams have players that are maybe better than anyone on Team USA, but that depth is too much, especially throughout an entire tournament. I mean, they'll have the targets on their backs, but I still think they're taking away gold.
Yeah, and a lot of the other international teams are not getting max participation as well. Ben Simmons has said he will not play for Team Australia. That really hurts them, as he is one of their most dynamic players. And then you have teams like Brazil, Argentina, are big-time powers usually. Their really generations are really older. Manu Ginobili, Pablo Prigioni, Andres Nocioni for Argentina, they're all retired. They won't be playing. Luis Scola, and then for Brazil, Nene, Anderson Varejão, Thiago Splitter, that's a lot of their big NBA guys. They're all too old now. They don't play either. So a lot of the competition has come down now, and it's mainly based on the European side. We have teams led by Luka Doncic, Goran Dragic, and stuff like that, where really some of the big competitors for the USA, Lithuania, they have Jonas Valanciunas, a couple other NBA guys, like you said. But I think you're right that when it comes down to it, and even if USA does have a couple of close games, I think that'll serve as a good wake-up call, and it might even mean other people coming back into the fold. But I think you're right, we'll need to worry. And then we'll move on to football, which is the start of training camp in the NFL, and the big thing right now is holdouts. You obviously have a lot of contract negotiations going on. And the thing we really need to hit on, I think, is the running back position, because you have Melvin Gordon and Ezekiel Elliott both threatening to sit out. They both want new contracts. And I think it's just very interesting because the running back position in the NFL is just so abused. It's so just not treated right. These guys are sitting on their rookie deals when, honestly, they're at their best when they're rookies, when they're coming out of college. You look at Saquon Barkley, Ezekiel Elliott, all these guys, their best years were when they're rookie years. And that's, these NFL teams are just running under the ground and they're not re-signing them to that second contract, which is where their big money is. They see these NBA deals and they want to get paid. And they, so Le'Veon Bell took it to another level. Some say he cost himself money. Who knows what Melvin Gordon and Ezekiel Elliott are going to do. I think if they want to get paid and they want to take a stand, they need to really come in like Le'Veon Bell and they need to join together as the running back position group and say, we need change. Like, we need to make our big contract our rookie contract. Let's get that first and then see where we're set. And then we don't have to worry about getting that big payday and destroying our bodies for 4 or 5 seasons. Or I think they need to sit out, honestly, because it's just the way the running back is contract right now and the way they are treated by NFL teams is just, it's not fair. And what do you say about that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm normally not the biggest fan of players sitting out, but at the running back position, I mean, one,
it's so brutal.
Guys that can make it past their rookie deal have a hard time. And then the second part is the running backs that have gotten the big money on their second contracts haven't worked out, so teams aren't willing to pay them on their second contracts anymore. You even saw that a little bit with Le'Veon Bell. I mean, he didn't get as much money as he probably would have 2 or 3 years ago. And, I mean, I think that Melvin Gordon and Ezekiel Elliott are going to end up playing this year. I think especially the Chargers, you can't have Melvin Gordon sit out. Phillip Rivers isn't getting any younger. You've got to be all in to try to win a Super Bowl. If he wants more money, you make it work. You need him for that offense. The Cowboys, you have a little bit more flexibility, but do you really want Dak Prescott having to carry the load of the offense? I think Prescott has shown he's an NFL caliber quarterback, but if he is the main weapon on offense, I don't think that's a winning combination. I think having Elliott and Prescott there is what's made the Cowboys offense successful. So I think both of them will end up on the field. And I think it is time, especially for the next collective bargaining agreement, whenever that is, they've got to change the way these rookie contracts are. Maybe you sign guys for 2 years and then they get a chance to go to arbitration. Yep. Kind of like baseball, you get that arbitration period before you become a free agent. Because, you know, running backs, defensive linemen, just in the NFL, the average career is 4 or 5 years, and that's how long these rookie deals are. So these guys need a chance to, if they perform, be able to go to someone independent and say, I deserve more money. I don't think they should get full free agency after 2 years, but you should be able to maybe say, go to arbitration with the team and say, I deserve more money. And I think that's probably a good compromise. Whether the owners will be willing to go for it, who knows? But I think it is time for a change in the way the NFL does their rookie contracts.
Yeah, I think that's a great point with arbitration. That's good, kind of a great middle ground there after 2 years. So the owners still have the ability to sign the player that they drafted, they invested all this capital in, and the player still gets a chance to get paid what they are worth. All right, we're going to just touch around on a quick few other things, just kind of talk about some different sports. Baseball, the Washington Nationals are the hottest team in baseball right now, really playing well after that tough start. Had a big win last night, 11-1 over the Rockies. Trey Turner hit for the cycle again against the Rockies. He is really fun to watch. Great young player for the Nationals. And right now they are tied 2-2 with the Rockies. Monday night's game was rained out, so this is a doubleheader. They're playing game one right now. We'll play again tonight at 7 o'clock. 2-2, top 7 for the Nationals. And then we are moving on to golf. It was a big weekend for golf. British Open, the last major of the year. And it was won by a guy who looks like he is not in the best shape or in the best athlete, really. He was won by a overweight Irishman, Shane Lowry, but he really just played one of the best rounds of golf I've ever seen. That third round, 63, he won it not necessarily in his home country, but on his home island. He said he was a golfer from the island of Ireland. He obviously won that in Northern Ireland, won that tournament. It was a great story. Wasn't the best finish, but it was a great story. He led wire to wire that last round, really had no competition, and you saw the emotion. He was there with his daughter, his wife. You saw the celebrating, and I'm sure he had quite a few pints after that open, or after that win. So good for Shane Lowry. And then coming up, we have college football. I mean, it's one of my favorite seasons of the year, and it's really, I mean, when you're in this dead period of the summer, you're really hanging on NFL training camp, NBA news, maybe some baseball if your team's in it. But really just trying to get us to college football, and there's just so much change with the transfers. There's new quarterbacks all over the place, and it really just should be an exciting season when it kicks off upcoming in August with the first game of the year. Miami, Florida in Orlando should be a great game, a great rivalry between those two schools. And that's going to do it for our roundtable, sports roundtable here for Nick Yore, Andrew Walker. If you want to see more coverage like this, make sure to tune in to DMVStream.com.
This content is brought to you by Dental Associates. For more than 39 years, Dr. Stephen Price has been practicing dentistry in Northern Virginia. A member of the American Dental Association, the Northern Virginia Dental Society, and the Virginia Dental Society, Price is considered an expert in Invisalign and continues to be an award-winning innovator in the industry.